All right. Thank you very much, everyone, for joining us. We're going to begin. My name is Matt Mahoney. I'm the Director of Government Affairs with Sustainable Pittsburgh. For everyone's aware, this webinar will be recorded, and all of the materials will be shared after today's program. At this time, we hope that you'll either enter your name and your organization into the chat, and I'd like to challenge everybody to a one-word challenge on what brought you here today. Why did you decide to attend today's webinar? So, to kick us off, I'd like to introduce Sustainable Pittsburgh. Sustainable Pittsburgh, we're committed to building the knowledge, perspective, and ability needed to create a better tomorrow for our region. We're optimistic, having worked with nearly 1,000 businesses, communities, and organizations to take action using our customized frameworks to track progress and simultaneously advance social equity, environmental stewardship, and prosperity. The strategic networks we host leverage the collective expertise and diverse perspectives within our region to ensure our communities can meet the challenges today and thrive into the future. And that's why we've invited you all today to attend with this Sustainable Community Development Network to learn together so we can act together. And together is how we co-create a fundamentally equitable, resilient, healthy, and prosperous Southwestern Pennsylvania. We'd like to take a moment to thank our sponsors, UPMC Health Plan, for their support, as well as PittOhio and Xylem for their silver support, and our other sponsors, as well as partners that have supported our ongoing work, such as webinars like this. So for today's agenda, we have a lot of good information today focused on sustainable procurement. So we're going to start off with a quick overview of Sustainable Pittsburgh's programs and our carbon reduction sprint from Sustainable Pittsburgh's Program Manager and Systems Administrator, Sora Seidlinger. And then next, we'll do a quick overview of what we mean when we refer to sustainable procurement to help set the stage for the presentations from the experts that we've invited. And they'll share insights about their programs that focus on the environmental, social, and economic impacts of their work. Along those lines, we're very happy to be joined by Jennifer Barnes, a Supplier Diversity and Sustainability Manager at the University of Pittsburgh, who will cover the university's sustainability initiatives and recent examples where sustainable procurement practices were implemented. Next, we'll hear from Lindsay Berger, Director of Business Operations with 3R Sustainability, who will provide an overview of how her business is implementing and supporting broader sustainability procurement practices. And our final speakers will be James Prager, Assistant Township Manager for Ferguson Township, and David Modricker, Director of Public Works for Ferguson Township, which is a Sustainable Pennsylvania Certified Gold municipality in Centre County, Pennsylvania, since 2015. And they'll speak about the different procurement policies that they've enacted. And of course, we'll leave time in for Q&A and discussion, and we'll hope that if you have any questions, please feel free to put them in the chat, or any other information that you'd like to hear more about on a certain topic, please feel free to put it in into the chat. But right now, I'd like to pass it off to my colleague Sawyer to talk more about the programs at Sustainable Pittsburgh and the Sustainable Pennsylvania Program partnership between Sustainable Pittsburgh and the Pennsylvania Municipal League and Sustainable Pittsburgh's second sprint challenge focused on carbon reduction. So, Sawyer, I'll let you take it away.
Thanks, Matt, and thank you everybody for joining us today. Before I get into more about our programs and the carbon reduction sprint, I want to first announce that we are doing a giveaway to win $100 to the grocery store of your choice. And you might have seen some information about that in our emails to you all. And we are actually extending that giveaway to 4 p.m. today, so don't wait. As I'm going through my slides, you're either going to be able to follow the link that Meredith is going to post in the chat right now, and go into that link and create your account and wait for that confirmation email or that password in the password creation email from Sustainable Pittsburgh. And once you're logged in, click on begin. And once you hit that begin button, you're going to then be eligible to be a part of that drawing to win that $100 gift card. And if you miss the QR code to use to create your login, again, you can use the link that Meredith is going to provide in the chat. And there's going to be the QR code that's going to be available in several of the slides moving forward as well. And again, you're going to need to not only create your account, but go through the process and then be able to begin the certification or designation program, which will then enter you into the sprint. But don't stop at begin, answer those questions, get involved. We also have a mini challenge that I'm going to talk about later on in my slides. Or later on at the end of this webinar. Get involved in the carbon reduction sprint and earn points and potentially win for the work that you're doing. And take away some of the actions that we're talking about today and try to put them into action before June, which is when the end of the sprint happens. We'll go to the next slide. So Sustainable Pittsburgh has four designation or recognition programs. We have the Sustainable Pittsburgh Shop Program, the Restaurant Workplace, and Sustainable Pennsylvania. And as I was talking about, we run carbon reductions, we run sprints. Historically, we had done the Social Equity Sprint last winter to early spring, and we are now in the carbon reduction sprint, which runs through to June. And we are providing a step-by-step process to track and measure sustainability progress, as well as a framework that organizations can use to drive measurable impact. These are based on market selected practices and peer reviewed by knowledge experts. When you're designated, you are then listed on our online directory, and you're able to we provide you with a digital badge and a physical window plane. And our designation levels are bronze, silver, gold, and platinum. Next slide, please. The Sustainable Pennsylvania program covers a comprehensive set of sustainability topics and provides step-by-step guidance for how your community can advance its performance in areas including waste and materials management, economic development, revitalization, and many more areas and issues. The Sustainable Pennsylvania program offers several benefits. First and foremost, it can help you baseline your community's current sustainability performance, as well as serve as an action plan for advancing your efforts. To help you advance your progress, the program also offers resources, tools, and best practices developed by over 60 advisors. Getting certified helps your community be recognized as a leader in sustainability, and you will receive a promotional kit, which includes a badge for inclusion on your website, job postings, and other uses, a press release template, and we'll also share your achievement over social media. Participation in this program can also help you resource your sustainable development initiatives and provide a platform for interested stakeholders to engage. Sustainable Pennsylvania is also recognized on the Pennsylvania Department of Community and Economic Development, or DCED, municipal funding applications, which could help a funding application stand out. There are just four steps in getting certified. First, you need to create an account, which actually at the beginning, whenever I mentioned about creating that account, it's going to be the same account. So the account that you would use to participate in the sprint would also be the same account that you use to get certified. So you can create an account on the Sustainable Pennsylvania website. For folks that are not municipalities that are on this call, which I know we have many, you would follow the Sustainable Pittsburgh website, or again, using the QR codes provided will take you to the landing page for municipalities and other types of organizations. Next, you're going to answer all the questions in the program. The program takes the form of an online assessment where questions are customized for municipalities, if you're a municipality, or looking at workplaces, shops, or restaurants, as I mentioned before. You can work with a team of colleagues to complete this, and which is a great way to organize a sustainability team at your municipality or your organization. Third, you're going to complete your assessment and submit it. Our staff will then provide feedback to your responses, and you'll have a chance to address any outstanding issues or questions that we might have in regards to your answers. Lastly, you're going to then earn bronze, silver, gold, or platinum certification based on two criteria: the total percentage of possible points you've earned, and whether or not you've completed required actions for each level. There's no deadline to participate, and certifications expire every 3 years. Right now, as I mentioned, we are in our carbon reduction sprint. These questions are pulled out, or actually, they're filtered down to the carbon reduction specific or targeted questions that are in the certification or recognition programs. So as you're completing these sprint questions, you're also contributing to the greater certification or recognition programs that we offer. The current sprint that we are in is a 6 months long. We've got about 3 months left, so plenty of time to still get in and mark your progress and try to win. The carbon reduction sprint, as you can see on the slide, ends on June 28th. It's pretty simple, as I mentioned about during the giveaway slide. You log in, create an account. You're going to wait for that confirmation email and your password creation email. You're going to click begin or continue if you're already engaged in the sprint, and then click sprint ahead to filter to those specific carbon reduction questions. If you do decide to move forward and get certified, if you are not a municipality, there is likely a fee involved. We have the option if for a needs-based waiver. So if you're unable to pay the fee that we have associated with a designation or certification program, we do offer a waiver to make you exempt from that. And all the municipalities under the Sustainable Pennsylvania program, that is free to continue and to get certified. So quickly, I'm just going to run through our leaderboards. These were just updated at the beginning of last month. We're going to be updating them again next week, at the end of next week. So again, it is the perfect time to get in and get started on the carbon reduction sprint. We can see where you're at. We're going to give feedback on the questions that you have answered. Again, use the QR code with your smartphone and get signed up. Thank you. And yes, you can see as we're working through, these are the SPRs that are involved or the Sustainable Pittsburgh restaurants. And lastly, you can see these three municipalities are involved. And you can see there's not many actions that they've taken. And so you could absolutely still get in this competition and see where you're at and win.
Perfect. Thanks so much, Sawyer. This is fantastic. And I hope everybody will take a moment to scan that QR code, take a moment to review the information, whether you're a workplace, a shop, a business, a municipality. Love for you to get involved. Now, I'd like to steer our attention to the content that we all came here to discuss. So let's dive into the content for today's discussion, Unlocking Sustainable Procurement Strategies. So setting the stage here, every purchasing decision made has an impact on the environment, economy, and society. I'll say that one more time. Every purchasing decision made has an impact on the environment, the economy, and society. And sustainable procurement helps us ensure that the environmental, social, and economic values of the goods and services we're interacting with align as best as possible with the values and benefits of the work that we all do. Advancing sustainable procurement improves cost savings, it decreases waste, achieves carbon reduction, and helps build stronger relationships that invigorate economic growth and trust in the community. Sometimes we hear sustainable procurement referred to as a few different things like sustainable purchasing, green purchasing, socially responsible procurement, or environmentally friendly purchasing. And this is really a testament to a maturing space where there are many different stakeholders exploring the value of sustainable procurement, and there are many different mechanisms that our speakers will explore that exist and are created to bring stronger support for sustainable procurement across many sectors. And an effective sustainable procurement strategy contributes to the overall financial health, operational efficiency, strategic positioning of your local government, your business, your organization. So wherever you're coming from us to today, there are certainly opportunities to advance sustainable procurement, and each of our speakers have a different organizational perspective to share. So hopefully you'll be able to gather some insights from our conversation today. Just very quickly to again sort of help level set and provide us all with equal grounds entering into the conversation. Sustainable procurement practices are an important piece of any sustainability strategy. Sustainable procurement can help organizations integrate requirements and criteria that align with how an organization values the protection of the environment and our society. The images you're looking at right now are developed by ICLEI, which is a global network that works with thousands of local and regional governments on sustainable developments, and they've provided a quick guide, which I encourage you to look at. There's a link that maybe some we can put in the chat. But they've developed a quick eight-page quick glance at sustainable public procurement, but a lot of the lessons and information is very transferable. And as you can see, the nice image on the left, sustainable procurement can generate fair wages, improved accessibility, stronger social inclusion, create better employment rates and opportunities, promote job growth, and it delivers consistent financial, social, and environmental benefits while future-proofing and de-risking supply chains and resource constraints. Now, I know that's a lot. And wherever you are on your journey, sustainable procurement policy may be a good place to start. It offers a platform and a space to think through how to systematically integrate sustainability considerations into everything from common purchasing that's needs for every day, and all the way through to the largest purchasing decisions that aren't as common. First great step in thinking about sustainable procurement policy is to gather support from peers, colleagues, decision makers on the importance and need for a comprehensive sustainable procurement policy to ensure there's shared foundational support whenever you get to a point where there's more interaction with decision makers on implementing those policies. And this helps ensure that the policy developed will be crafted from a holistic perspective and ensure that there's recognition of the broad impacts of sustainable procurement strategies. And you'll see on the right-hand side, which is more of how to initiate and begin the process of developing a procurement process or a procurement policy rather, by gathering support from peers and building the case with decision makers. Engaging peers is important, and building that support and evidence of the benefits of sustainable procurement lay the foundation for that policy process. And it's important to be specific, measurable, achievable, relevant, time-bound, you know, those SMART goals when we're developing those policy bounds or crafting those policy questions. And you can think of what opportunities may exist for collaborations with partners on operational aspects of your work, like waste management or transportation, and think through what alternatives may exist that can reduce costs in one category to free up budget to invest in another area. So, thinking globally now about how this fits into the larger regional conversation, sustainable procurement policies have gained traction over the past few decades. And more recently, with federal funding programs, there's a certain focus on procurement requirements, such as domestic content, prevailing wage requirements, especially in the clean energy space. And from a regional multi-sector equity-driven decarbonization strategy perspective, there's a growing sense of urgency for decarbonizing multiple sectors. And honestly, and arguably, procurement touches on so many different sectors. It is an essential part of the pie and an essential cog in the wheel in those solutions. So now let's hear from our experts who are really leading the way and leading the charge on implementing these sustainable policies. So first, I'm happy to introduce Jennifer Barnes as the University of Pittsburgh Supplier Diversity and Sustainability Manager. Jennifer works with the Strategic Sourcing Procurement Team in purchasing services, helps advance socially and environmentally responsible purchasing. In her role, Jennifer collaborates with university departments and major contracted suppliers to track, analyze, and increase diverse and sustainable spending. And she's also a member of the university's Chancellor Advisory Council on Sustainability and Carbon Commitment Committee. Her contributions at Pitt and within the community have garnered her prestigious recognition, and she's trained as a city planner with a background in community, workforce, and economic development. So, Jennifer, we're excited to hear more about the work that you're doing, and I'll let you take it away from here.
Yeah, And hi, everybody. I'm so excited to be here this afternoon, and excited to share a little bit about what the University of Pittsburgh is working on as far as sustainable procurement. As Matt said, my name is Jennifer. I use she/her pronouns. I've been at the University of Pittsburgh for almost 5 years, working with the purchasing and strategic sourcing teams within the CFO's office. My primary history with procurement has been on the construction side and housing development, and I started working with local businesses in federal awards for housing, public housing, and that led me into division of public funds and making sure there was equitable access for work on the job site for people in the community as well as local businesses. And when I started at Pitt, I focused mostly on supplier diversity, but has added sustainability as well. I'm originally from California, so sustainability is more of a passion of mine than like a specific work experience, but I've brought a lot of that knowledge from the different cities that I've lived in, and hopefully can continue to contribute to Pittsburgh and the University of Pittsburgh. So I do want to thank Sawyer for inviting me. Sawyer and I worked closely together at Pitt when I first started 4.5 years ago. So I'm really grateful for that, those conversations and that entry. You can go to the next slide. So I do want to talk a little bit just level setting, and I did forget one image on this slide. So the University of Pittsburgh established the Office of Sustainability after the university ran a sustainability like research program, which developed the Pitt Sustainability Plan. That was in 2018. And due to that plan, the Office of Sustainability was created. After that, the plan for Pitt was launched, and then most recently, the Climate Action Plan was launched 2 years ago. So the plan for Pitt that's listed here on the top left is currently being updated. We just received a new chancellor last year, and so under her purview, we are updating the plan for Pitt. So we're looking at 2028. But the Climate Action Plan is more of a specific guideline into how the university is going to achieve carbon neutrality by 2037, which is the university's anniversary year, I think 250th anniversary. So that is our main goal. But a lot of what my office does and the procurement team has to do with what the Pitt Sustainability Plan outlines for us. So that plan focuses on stewardship, exploration, community, and culture. So within the stewardship component, materials and waste are the major overlap between our procurement office and the Office of Sustainability. So to do that, we focus on purchasing sustainably in three different ways, mainly. Number one is updating and providing resources to our staff, as well as faculty and students, but primarily our end users, with people that use our system to make purchases. We include a lot of that language in our RFPs, and we include a lot of touch points in execution of the contracts that we go into. And then there's also solutions for those end users after an award is made, and the communication that we have with those suppliers after the award is made. Go to the next slide. So the website, our purchase, pay, and travel website, which is accessible to anyone, is our primary resource for anybody on campus, any of our end users that have access either to the knowledge or to the purchasing system. So while you have to have special access for the purchasing system itself, you can learn a little bit more about how those guidelines are determined as far as sustainable purchasing. So there's a section under our Purchase, Pay, and Travel website that lists all of our sustainability initiatives, as well as specific guidelines for sustainability based on commodity. Some of those, like usually cleaning products or lighting, things like that, are usually managed by our facilities office, but the guidelines are still accessible if people have questions about how we are promoting sustainability within those specific departments. So Also listed there are some supplier-led achievements. So if one of our contracted suppliers is doing something really cool or has a new project or program that we want our end users to know about, we will highlight it on this website as well. Some of the specific initiatives that I think might be of interest are our chemical redistribution program, which is managed through our environmental health and safety. So if one lab doesn't use all of their chemicals, they can go through AHNS to share those with other labs, so those labs don't have to pay either to dispose unused chemicals or pay for a new chemical. So it's like a nice sharing redistribution. And then also listed there, we can have guidelines for purchasers. If there isn't a specific commodity listed in something that they're buying, we give them guidance on what to look for and making sustainable choices. Like, does this supplier have an end of life or a take back program? Do they use compostable or more sustainable packaging? Simple sort of guidelines like that for people when they're making purchasing decisions. And then the last thing that's listed that I wanted to highlight on our PPT website are any upcoming shows or training activities. So every April during Earth Month, we host either circular procurement or sustainable procurement seminar or webinar. And that's usually recorded and linked here on the PPT website, so people can watch it anytime if they want to learn more about sustainable procurement or how to purchase more sustainably. You can go to the next slide. So the supplier show is another way that we're able to share information with our end users. So this was actually just from Thursday. We had our most recent sustainable supplier show on Thursday. We had over 130 staff, faculty, and students registered to attend. And we had 27 of our contracted suppliers attend and bring their more sustainable products or services to discuss. This show was a little bit different. We did it in partnership with the Office of Sustainability. So this was a Green Office and Green Lab sustainable supplier show. And when I say Green Office or Green Lab, we have two different designations for offices and labs. In the bottom left corner, you can see some of the icons. You can, any office can submit their information and their practices to attain a Green Office designation, and labs can do the same. We have about 400 plus labs on campus, and of those, only 22 are currently registered as Green Labs. And for our offices, we have 64 Green Offices. But you can also register as a Green Staff Member or a Green Faculty Member or a Green Ambassador. So we have over 770 staff and faculty members who are registered and have gone through this assessment. So all of them were invited to the Sustainable Supplier Show to get free samples, to ask questions of the suppliers directly about the things that they're buying. So K-Cups and Keurig was one of the ones that was people asked a lot. They want to know more about them. Typically, all of our suppliers really only talk with the procurement folks. So this was a really nice way for people actually doing the purchasing to talk to the reps directly. So we had Grainger, Thermo Fisher, Boise, Office Depot, ODP, BIC, Keurig, VWR. So we're talking about sustainable lab equipment, sustainable office equipment, and it kind of ran the gamut. So it was a successful show. We also concurrently ran a webinar. So every 10 minutes, one of the suppliers in the show, sorry, we're saving energy here, so my light goes off sometimes. Every 10 minutes, the suppliers will have an opportunity to present on the most sustainable attributes and achievements of their company. And so people were able to come based on the schedule and hear from the reps as well, and then visit their tables to get freebies. So we go to the next slide. So this is where I think I spend the majority of my time. And as professionals, I think most of you are familiar with the RFP process. So I'm responsible for drafting the language that goes into our RFPs, that either university-wide contracts that go through our strategic sourcing office or our smaller department or a department-wide RFPs that go through our purchasing services office. Regardless, I'll draft the language and amend it depending on the specific category. So I wanted to share an example of what that would actually look like in practice. So the first one, when I first started about 4 years ago, the university underwent a food service RFP process, which was about an 18-month process. And in that RFP, with very specific goals and expectations for our partner, as far as the type of meals that were going to be provided, where the ingredients were going to be sourced, and other sustainable goals and pledges. So we awarded that contract to Chartwell's or Compass. And as a part of that agreement and negotiations, they committed to waste a certain percentage of waste diversion, as well as waste audits every quarter to track that. They had sustainable food pledges like the Cool Food and Real Food pledges. And so they made those commitments to us. And because my position is responsible for both diverse purchasing as well as sustainable purchasing, we crafted specific goals for 15% spend with diverse businesses, as well as goals for local procurement. So with food, it's within a 100-mile radius, which could be Ohio, it could be Pennsylvania, but they track and give us that information every quarter on where the food is being purchased, how much is being spent with local businesses. The second one that we finalized about a year ago was with our scientific supplier, university-wide scientific supply provider, which is Thermo Fisher. As a result of that RFP negotiation, we were able to successfully receive financial support from our contracted supplier to support specific sustainability programs, one of which is a green sample box, which has about 15 different greener option samples for labs to purchase. So those sample boxes are being sold for 1 penny. They're stocked in our Dietrich stockroom here, so labs can order them and see what more sustainable options and switches they could potentially make. And then we'll get feedback and give that feedback to Thermo Fisher. We are using a local woman-owned business to do the kitting for those. She found compostable boxes. She's used plant-based ink as a stamp on those compostable boxes, so we're not running into any issues with the compost of those boxes. So a lot of that went into those, and that's because of some negotiation from that contract. In addition, we're able to launch a pipette tip recycling program, and that will be live in the next 2 weeks, because pipette and pipette tip boxes are one of the most purest forms of plastics in the lab. And so we're piloting an initiative with a company called Polycarbon to recycle those. They also give us sustainability reporting and have really great benchmarks and tool, what do you call them? Like live dashboards that show us exactly what our sustainable purchasing looks like with them. And then, as I mentioned, that there's a focus on sustainable products, and they'll give us information every quarter. The last one I want to highlight is our maintenance, repair, and operations RFP. Our current supplier is Grainger. They give me quarterly greenhouse gas reporting. They give us what pops up automatically in the Grainger punch out is if you purchase like a cleaning chemical, what will automatically pop up is, hey, this is a greener quote unquote option for the purchase that you're trying to make. Would you like to switch to this greener option? So that's led us to have about a third of all purchases through Grainger be attributed to some type of eco label. And we also requested that they have a minimum percentage of the products available in their catalog have some type of eco label, eco rating as well. You can go to the next slide. So a lot of that reporting ends up making my life easier when we do our HG Stars reporting or we do our annual greenhouse gas reporting. I get those reports. I can follow up and talk to them individually. We collect greenhouse gas reporting every year on paper, computers, cleaning products, as well as travel, which I'll talk about in a second. But then every 3 years, we do our larger HD STARS reporting, which will include all of those as well as additional supplier information. But already having that cadence with the suppliers really helps make HD less of a hassle. So the HD, we just received our gold status again in 2024 as a university, which is really exciting for us. And so we're still, you know, increasing how we're doing as a university compared with our peers. So I also wanted to show some examples of what looks like in practice. So the last slide and this slide are examples of what the punch outs potentially look like. This is the Fisher Scientific punch out. If you click it one more time, I think it'll circle what I wanted to highlight. So there's a, you can't really see it that well down here, but there's a little option that says greener choice. So if you're, so if I'm looking just for gloves and I want to sort by the greener choice, I can click that special interest key and that will pop up with gloves that have either an eco label or a greener choice product. That is something that we've been able to curate with Fisher through the advancement of this punch out technology. I think that's it. I have my contact information here. If you have questions that we're not able to answer today, or if you want to follow up with me, please feel free. And thank you for your time.
Thank you so much, Jennifer. That was very insightful and very helpful. I have a few questions. I'm going to hold them until the very end, though. A lot of good information, and like I like the shared resources as well. So let us, though, keep moving on so we can hear from our other speakers as well. So next, we have Lindsay Berger, who serves as the Director of Business Operations at 3R Sustainability and supports the 3R team across sustainability consulting projects. Lindsay is fueled by a passion for the natural environment and the role it plays in human health, and her background in biology led her to obtain a master's degree in sustainability from Chatham University's Falk School of Sustainability. So without further ado, I'd like to hand it off to Lindsay.
Thanks, Matt. All right, we'll jump right into it. So just for some level setting, you can go to the next slide. About 3R, we are, as Matt said, a consulting firm. Our consulting arm started in 2015, and today we sit at the intersection of the built environment and corporate social responsibility and management consulting. So we have a team of experts that are really focused on green building certifications, and then another subset of the team that's focused really on the day-to-day operations of sustainable business practices. Just want to highlight some of the principles and certifications that we retain as an organization. Women-owned business is one that I'll mention later on as well, as one of those diversity certifications that you might look for in your own supply chain. And then we're also a certified B Corporation and recognized Just Label. And also we'll talk about EcoVadis in a moment as well. But just demonstrating that as an organization, and we try to do things first ourselves and then work to help other organizations achieve kind of the same or similar objectives in their own journey. Next slide. So jumping right into some of the actions that we take as a service provider, you know, oftentimes if you aren't, you know, manufacturing products, sometimes it might not be as obvious kind of the levers that you do have to control. So as a service provider, wanted to highlight some of the things that we do internally and with our employees. First is starting with that organizational level commitment and having an established policy that just really details our commitment to social equity, diversity, and environmental preferences and requirements for various products and services that we do actually procure. For our employees to take a little bit more ownership and operationalize some of our commitments, each employee has their tailored expense reporting where we have them track emissions or the miles that are then converted to kind of emissions associated with business travel. We always try to deliver our services 100% remote when possible. So as a consulting company, you know, that business travel is part of oftentimes one of the largest kind of greenhouse gas emissions impacts. And then also on that expense reporting, the different lodging options and renting cars or ride share services, there's preferences for things like EVs and greener hotels and things like that. When we do have catered meals in the office, our office is located in the Strip District, so there's really no lack of local great restaurants for us to choose from for in-office catering. But for our remote employees, which we have many of in the past, in light of the past few years, whenever we do something like in lunch for the employees or gifts, we always make sure that gift cards and things like that are local to where our employees reside. For our IT and website development, marketing support, we utilize all small local providers. And for any branded products that we do have, are also local screen printing and embroidery companies. So just highlighting some of the impacts as a service provider, some of the actions that we take at a high level here, you can see some of the things that we are able to control internally. Where most of our impact is really realized through the work that we do with our clients. So Matt, next slide, please. So going to walk through kind of these high level steps of the process that we'd work through with a client to help them establish their own sustainable procurement program. I have organizational commitment here labeled as number zero, because if you're here, I don't think we need much of an introduction to that organizational commitment, because you're here and curious about it and have clearly identified sustainable procurement as an impact for your organization. We'll discuss some of the steps for data collection, goal setting, and then some additional actions that you could take. All right, so to touch on the organizational commitment, as with anything related to sustainability, we really want to make sure that your sustainability initiatives are ingrained into your organization's business strategy and that it's not seen as this adjacent group over here doing that thing. So whether you've gone through a materiality assessment or you just simply know that this is a big impact for you, sustainable procurement itself might be one of those major impacts, as well as it could be an action that you take to help achieve some of your other organizational goals that you might have around diversity, equity, inclusion, or your emissions reductions goals. Matt, at the start of the meeting, also walked through kind of the benefits of a sustainable procurement program, and some of the components that I'll detail include the policy checklists and committees to operationalize your commitment. Okay. This is just a study, some stats here that you could see that were done by the World Economic Forum, that demonstrates how having a sustainable procurement program not only can help with cost reduction and revenue increase, but also boost brand value. So really the first step is your data collection. So before we can set goals and take actions to achieve them, we need to understand your baseline within your supply chain. The very first piece is understanding what you procure. That might sound very obvious and simple, but you'd be surprised what you find when you engage the right people in your organization to understand the full scope of what is procured for your organization. This includes products and service providers as well, employee expenses, and just overall organizational spend. So really, to understand your supply chain, even the first step that's not listed here is just understanding those who are responsible in your organization for procurement and can help gather that list. Once you do have that list of your full spend, it's helpful to then categorize your purchased goods and services. A common method for prioritization is based on spend. So maybe you want to focus on, you know, top 1%, top 5% of your spend. And that's going to depend greatly on your organization, the size of your spend, to how detailed you prioritize. At this point, it's also then helpful to understand those goods and service providers that you do have more control over than others, to see where you may be able to Utilize existing relationships to help, you know, down the line when you want to take some action. At this next step, then, is you'll baseline that spend. Maybe it's helpful at this point to understand, once you understand your current supply chain, how much is already from local suppliers, how much may already retain some diversity certifications. Again, you may be surprised at this point to understand that a lot of your existing supply chain does meet some of the criteria or preferences that you're looking for. This next step then is also to includes assessing the risk within your supply chain. So there's a few different ways that you can collect this information. Again, depending on your service and good suppliers, there may be a lot of public information on those organizations, especially some of the large public ones, where you have access to public indices based on public indices that rate different companies based on kind of ESG risk, and can help kind of raise alerts for any of your suppliers that may or may not have a risk of being involved with certain social issues in the supply chain. The other step here is then potentially considering tailoring questionnaires. So you can reach out proactively to your supply chain to understand if this information is not public. Maybe you start questioning them at this point to get a better sense of where they are in their own journey. Letting them know that you're starting down this path of your own for sustainable procurement and you want to bring them along with you. Some third parties that you could use, we tend to see these third parties utilized from some larger public companies like Supplier.io, Cloppify, EcoVadis, which are all either databases or third parties that can assess supplier risk and kind of their ESG rankings across a variety of themes. Next slide. So that data collection is clearly kind of where most of the leg work happens. And once you have a good understanding of your supply chain, existing diversity certifications, and kind of the status of your different suppliers, you can then work to set some goals. So I wanted to provide a few examples here of different goal types that you could look at setting related to sustainable procurement. The first one there is an engagement goal. So in the next step, we'll talk about some of the actions you can take and policies that you may want to create, one of which being a sustainable code of conduct for your suppliers that you would share proactively with them. Another goal might be around supplier diversity. So you may look at that one as a percent of total spend with minority-owned businesses that you want to increase across your total spend. Another goal that may be applicable to you based on your industry is the product goal. So thinking about, based on the products that you do have, could they be more recyclable? Could they have FSC certification for paper products, some of those other third-party certifications that would be worth looking into to understand, based on the products that you do procure, could they be greener, have less emissions associated with them? And then similarly for local procurement, you may want to have that as a goal to increase your local spend by 10% across by 2030, for example. So how can you actually achieve those goals? As I mentioned, as part of that organizational commitment, the first step is to really understand what you're doing as an organization and establishing that commitment, formalizing those goals. Maybe it's in reference to some other globally recognized standards like the UN Global Compact or the Sustainable Development Goals. There's a lot of resources out there that can help inform what is best practice for a sustainable procurement. I mentioned EcoVadis already. That's another one that we'll share publicly. Some great references for what a procurement policy should contain, KPIs that you should be tracking. Once you have that policy internalized, at this point is where you might run into some resistance with your procurement team, where there may be some long-lasting relationships with suppliers, and we don't want to just cut them off. So one thing that we have found really helpful with our clients is the creation of procurement checklists. And you can view this as sort of a step in the right direction to get the procurement team and other employees thinking about the different preferences that you'll have as an organization. Starting to think about things like, do we even need this product anymore? Can it be sourced locally? And can I find it from someone else that maybe has more of a preference for environmentally friendly materials? So by creating these checklists, it's not saying, day one, here's our requirements and we're flipping a switch and going to completely change all of our suppliers. It's starting to have those conversations internally and enabling your procurement team to have these conversations with your existing suppliers. And that really feeds into that collaboration with existing suppliers and leads into the creation of an external supplier code of conduct. So related to one of the goals on the prior slide, you may create the supplier code of conduct, share it with your suppliers, have them read it, and maybe agree to changing things that they might need to meet your goals. Or they may know that there's sort of a transition period where they either get on board or know that you will have to find other suppliers to help you meet your goals. Next slide. That was it. So just wrap it up here then. It's really all about kind of starting with what are you doing internally as an organization, formalizing that commitment, helping your employees along the way to kind of get thinking about what they can do, and then working with your existing suppliers to help them understand your goals and maybe help them set some of their own. Don't hesitate to reach out. I think you'll share my contact information if there's any specific questions for me. Thanks all.
Thanks so much, Lindsay, and certainly appreciate the unique perspective of walking the talk and providing those services out in the field. So very helpful. And I do have questions, but we do have another presenter, actually two, that we'd like to highlight and provide an opportunity to speak on from a municipality's perspective. So we're fortunate to be joined by two folks. James Prager serves as the Assistant Township Manager for Ferguson Township. Again, I mentioned shout out. They're a gold certified municipality since 2015, located in Center County, PA. And we're also joined by David Modricker, a licensed professional engineer with a construction administration and engineering design background, has been working in public works with Ferguson Township for 25 years. So we're very fortunate to be joined by both of these experts to talk about how they're advancing sustainable purchasing.
Thanks, Matt. So I'll just get right into it here and try to keep it short and sweet for you. So you can go on to the first slide. So like Matt said, Ferguson Township is located in Center County. We have about 19,000 residents. It's a pretty diverse area, three different wards, and we run the gamut from urban development area to agricultural uses. So there's a lot of different interests, a lot of different vested interests in here, and a lot of different ideas in the township. So it kind of forms the way we begin to think about that. And what I want to do right now is just give you a little bit of a framework of how we got to where we are today and some of the places we see ourselves going forward. So go ahead. So one of the things about Ferguson Township is that it's a home rule municipality. And what that means for the uninitiated into local government lingo is that we have the ability to make our own laws that aren't superseded by the state or federal government. So that kind of gives us a little bit of impetus for kind of setting our own path forward. And if you go to the next slide, In 2012, the township adopted the Community and Environmental Bill of Rights. And among other things, what that called out was the right to pure water, the right to clean air, the right to natural communities, and the rights to a sustainable energy future for residents. And so that really starts, that's really like the baseline of where we began taking this direction and really trying to you know, go in a sustainable direction and try to achieve some of these goals that we have here. So go to the next slide, please. So the end result with that, of that, not the end result, but one of the results of that is in 2020 was the construction of a LEED facility, LEED Green Building facility, and that is our new public works facility. We call that Building 6 colloquially. And there's solar panels on the roof. It's a net zero facility. We're getting pretty close to that. I think my colleague Dave can speak a little bit more in detail about this, but we're getting pretty close to reaching that goal. In February of 2023, we held a ceremony for the LEED Green certification. So that's kind of like our gem, our crown jewel of the township, so to speak, facilities in terms of meeting some of these initiatives. So next slide, please. So what this really forced then to achieve this particular goal was to focus on policy. Policy kind of, you know, that really is the shape maker, I guess you would say. It forms everything that you do. It forms all of the decisions that you make. So if you go to the next slide, we can take a look at some of those policies. So there are prerequisite policies to attaining LEED green status. In this case, we initiated the LEED green cleaning policy, which focuses on all of the cleaning products that we use, the methods that we use them, the types of equipment that we use. It really sets the tone for how we go about what our strategy is for cleaning these buildings. Now, this in particular, like I said, this was part of attaining LEED status for Building 6. However, this is something that we've done township-wide, and we continue to try to implement in as many areas as possible. It just so happened that it kind of spawned, like I was saying, from Building 6, but it really has grown into something, a cultural thing that we try to achieve in all of our buildings. So next slide, please. This also led to the sustainable purchasing policy, and this policy applies to consumables, durable goods, building materials, alterations, mercury-containing lamps, and I'll get into that in a minute, but the goal of this policy is to protect the environment and public health, conserve natural resources, minimize waste. There's a lot of items that, you know, our day-to-day uses, our office uses, that get covered in this as well. So it kind of forms what we do, and it kind of ties back to the other presentations before this one, where it really, really having that policy can help you achieve a number of things, including putting things in place where you get the green alternative pop-up whenever you purchase from Amazon, or you can find vendors that can meet these standards. It can really help with and assist vendor selection. So next slide, please. In the personnel policy manual as well, we also established a tobacco control policy, and that is for a tobacco-free workplace, essentially. Again, it's part of the prerequisites of the LEED Green facility, but this is something that we've done facility-wide, and we're able to identify a couple of spaces more than 25 feet away from the building where smoking is permitted, but within the building, on the grounds, all tobacco is prohibited, including smokeless tobacco and e-cigarettes. Next slide, please. So how are we going about implementing this? And Matt, you can scroll through some of these photos. I won't get too stuck on each individual item, but there's alternative choices to everything you make, and this to every decision you make. In this case, as we've seen, some alternatives like having a smaller toilet paper roll holder with a a smaller tube for that is one small tiny choice, but it makes a big difference overall and over time. So if you keep scrolling through, again, with paper towel holders, this is something that was just adopted recently that was changed in the restroom facilities here. The next picture, so this is cleaning supplies. You don't often think of this too much of whenever you're purchasing these things or where you're getting them from, but the township was able to switch away from using big box retailers, working with a wholesale company, a local wholesale company that we were able to give those policies to, and they're able to give us choices, give us options that meet the standards in those policies. So that's a bit, that makes a big difference as you're moving forward. Again, with mercury lamps, using a smaller tube for fluorescent light bulbs and the way that you dispose of them, that's another area where we're able to make some, we're able to make some changes. It's expensive to do it all at once. We do it as we go. As things need to be replaced, we try to make the best choice that we can in that decision and keep improving from there. So that's kind of where we've gone with the lights. Paper, a funny anecdote about paper is that I think whenever anyone shows up on a new job, they kind of expect to be the budget slasher. And I naively took this look at how much we were spending on paper as an organization. And it really brought into focus one of the main challenges of sustainable procurement for an organization of our size. And what that was is I thought that I could analyze the amount we were spending on paper and the amount of paper we were using and come up with some sort of formula or some sort of plan where I could reduce that cost. What happened from there was that, as Dave informed me, well, this paper really is the paper that meets the criteria in the policy. And when I started looking at it, I couldn't really get it any cheaper than we were already getting it. And but what I did realize was that one of the challenges was that each department didn't quite have that same culture. So one thing that's been really successful for us is our public works facility has been really good at implementing a lot of these policies and achieving some of these goals. For other departments, it's not in the it's not the main focus. When you have procurement that is decentralized and not centralized in it in your finance department, you have different people making different decisions on how and what they're going to purchase. It can be quite challenging to get everyone on board with the same processes. So that's something that we continue to strive toward. Again, this is from the a building addition project where we were able to give to the policy to the contractor to say, this is what we'd like to, this is our sustainability plan, this is our sustainable purchasing policy, and as our contractor, you need to follow this as well. And they put together a plan where they're able to meet a lot of those policies. One thing here is that I will say that it doesn't prohibit us from doing anything if there's a way that we can identify a better cost or a faster way to complete the project. We do have some flexibility, but overall, it's really helpful to be able to hand a contractor a policy and say, like, here's what we do, and that's the expectation. It saves a lot of time and a lot of speeds up a lot of decision making as well. Next slide, please. In this case, for the construction project, and you might be able to hear it going on with me right now, there's a waste policy that's attached to this, that all the waste materials are taken out to a dumpster, and then the dumpster is taken and sorted for recyclable materials later. So that's one way that just in a project that's happening here right now as we speak, that we're able to meet some of those goals. Again, with the no smoking, the tobacco control policy, having signed designated places where people can and cannot smoke, that is contributes to the goals as well. Like I said before, these fixtures, it's not always feasible for an organization to just go through and do it all at once. They have to be done sometimes as needed. So when things need replacing, the township will try to do whatever it can to meet the needs of the policy while meeting the needs of the township and the residents as well. Again, this is an example of an Energy Star appliance that the township uses. That's again another choice that we always put the best foot forward on whenever it's available. We try to make those choices. And our LEED building actually feeds back data to us in real time. And on our website, you can view this in real time. There's a link on our website that shows you this dashboard. It's also in the lobby of our LEED building. It's showing you what is happening in the building in real time. So we can see how we're doing on our goals, what our percentages are of energy use, how much we're producing. And you can see the categories in the photo, but yeah, it's an interesting thing. And I think it always is surprising whenever you can see those numbers in real time and see how it's actually working. It's a pretty impressive thing to have and keeps it in the front of your mind at all times. So I'll turn it over for any questions now. I think I would just, note that sometimes with an organization, it's hard to get everyone on the same page, but the policy is what forms the culture. And it's the bridge between this decision-making process and the people who are making those decisions. So I'll end there. Thanks, Matt.
Well, thanks so much, James. And those last words were very endearing for me. It is certainly important, and I'm glad that you were able to highlight that aspect. If we could have our speakers come back onto the screen for any questions. I did see a few in the chat, but I wanted to ask a few myself while listening. So there were a few processes, of course, that are mentioned throughout any procurement strategy. And so wondering, there was mention of a shared chemical program that Jennifer mentioned at the University of Pittsburgh for sharing, purchasing, and disposal. Are there other areas, or other examples of other industries and areas where there are there are opportunities for sharing resources or sharing services, either between businesses or between different departments within a university, based on your own experiences, of course. But just wanting to hear if there's any other examples of where successful collaboration on procurement strategies has been helpful.
Two answers to that from Pitt's perspective. One internally and one more of like a partnership approach. Internally, we have a department called Surplus Properties, and they are able to collect extra equipment, usually furniture, laptops, things like that, that are either disused or like if an office renovates and they have extra tables, chairs, file cabinets, things like that, then that is translated and transferred to Surplus Properties. They'll come pick that up, and then they either can just give it to another department that might be in need or sell it to the public. And obviously that might not be an option for a lot of organizations. I mean, we don't have the space to store those items, but the Pitt Surplus Properties, you can go online and see what's up for auction, or you can go to the warehouse and Point Breeze if you're looking for, a table or something like that. So that's accessible. So it could be potentially a shared resource amongst offices and departments to, find a new home for old furniture and things like that. It's also money-making as far as like the technology. They will wipe printers and laptops and things like that and then resell them sometimes in bulk. So it is a potential income stream as well. And then a recent partnership that we underwent as a university, we partnered with Temple University and Penn State when we were looking to renew our office supply contract. And so the three universities worked together to combine our buying power, purchasing power, and through that combination, we were able not only to save money, but also ask for things from our potential suppliers that support our sustainability initiatives. We shared how we do our reporting. We shared programming that we'd like to get financing for and things like that. So I think if there is an option to cooperate with another, like a partner organization or a peer, then you're able to do some interesting things like that.
Thank you so much. That was great. You covered just about every element of that question, internal, external, and thinking about the larger, bigger picture too. So thank you. There was another question in the chat. So a lot of the language, or a lot of this, requires standard contract language for RFPs and such. Are there any good resources that maybe we can plug into the chat for folks that would be helpful for some of that standard language, just to start gleaning and pulling that information together?
I think I would have permissions sharing.
Oh no. I see that Jennifer's screen has frozen. I maybe
our standard language, if people want to reach out to me, Dad, our standard language with Allegheny County as they were creating their purchasing plan. So if that is available in any public sense, the county has some of our language in it as well. And then we also are a member of Sustainable Purchasing Leadership Council, and we use a lot of their best practices for specific commodity focus, like most recently for paper and our office supplies and our lab. So that's also a good partner. And I'll add that in the chat.
Fantastic. And Lindsay, James, do you have anything to add there that you'd like to?
I'd just add, and I think Jennifer mentioned a couple already, but for what we've seen mostly with a lot of our clients is the utilization of different industry associations. So if you're not already members of, based on your industry, there's plenty out there, I'm sure, just for shared best practices. But just one thing that we commonly do as a first step in adding to contract language with suppliers is that kind of preference language before you introduce requirements for them. And I'd plug EcoVadis again as well for some great kind of templates and standard language that you could look into that they make available.
I think, you know, I'll look to Dave for insight on this one. He handles our competitive bidding process, but I think, again, having the policies in place, I know it's something that I refer to anytime I'm looking at really anything we're about to purchase. I try to be aware of what's in that policy and then include that language, even if it's not everything we do fits into the same boat. So we do a lot of stuff at a township, so you end up running into a lot of different scenarios. So I don't know, Dave, if you have any insight on your end into that.
Sure. We were fortunate to work with a consultant through the design process for our LEED Gold Public Works building. And as part of that, we were provided some templates for our purchasing and waste management resolutions, adopted them as resolutions. They could always stand improvement, and I've really appreciated listening to the other speakers and taking some notes. But then certainly whenever we have contracts, we'll provide this to the architects or to some vendors and ask that they incorporate these provisions into them. So as James mentioned, they were added to the building addition renovation contract by the architect. So that helps us meet our goals with purchasing carpet that's low VOC, paint that's low VOC, contractor has a waste management plan, recycling, and whatnot.
Thank you so much. And that is all the time we have for today's presentation. Is Sawyer still on? If you don't mind plugging our sprint one more time, just real quick, just so folks have the info.
Yes. Again, we are doing the carbon reduction sprint right now. And I teased at the beginning that we're doing a mini challenge. We've done one, I believe, every month. And the mini challenge is to have 25% of the total points earned in the sprint before April 5th. So that is just in 3 days to earn 5 bonus points on top of the points that you earned already. And we're also running a refer a friend bonus points. So if you're able to get a participant to sign up, create an account, and then click begin, we will award you, the person that referred that person, 5 bonus points. So really get in there. And again, the link was in the chat to sign up. I know we already had 3 people create leads during this presentation. Get in there. So then not only can you get these bonus points potentially, but you know, the chance to win $100 gift card for the grocery store of your choosing. So yeah, create an account today.
Thanks so much, Sawyer. And thank you all for joining us today, especially to our speakers, Lindsay, James, David, and Jennifer. If you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to us here at Sustainable Pittsburgh. And thank you for, and we'll circulate the resources, the links that were discussed. We'll certainly send those out, as well as some of the additional resources that our speakers send to us. So thank you all for joining. Thank you to our speakers. And thanks for working to advance sustainability within your communities.
Thanks, everyone.